Now, this is a new town, and we will talk about the elements of new towns now. So, for rural development and regenerative economy, new town can be a very interesting element. We could reverse over-urbanization. Today, there are far too many people living in cities. And at the same time, we could make cities a lot more resilient. Cities at the moment are, well, not really regenerating their resources, that are they are extracting the resources from around and not being, well, creating a good future, but rather than destroying the regions around. So we can combine the upsides of urban life with the upsides of the rural, and that's one of the key points: make good life possible. New town is an open vision to create millions of interesting livelihoods, and actually all of you are invited to participate. It requires many people to go ahead, so few people are taking the lead, and so entrepreneurial people are needed. And so, yeah, but first more on the concept and the basic ideas. If you want to move to the rural, you want to have an interesting environment, so beautiful landscape and all that, well, that can exist. But the main thing is that most people want to have interesting people around, and I include myself. So to make it viable in regions where nothing much is left, and that's very common, increasingly common with the depopulation of rural areas, it would be wise to start with maybe 150 to 300 people. Depends on the culture, of course, but this is a good size that, well, enough interesting people are there, children of the same age are there, so that would be a good starting point. And starting too small may create failure, so make it big enough to be viable. The idea is to convert farms to clusters of market gardens, and the illustration here to the left shows how that could look like. So that would be small market gardens gathered around the old farm building as sort of the village center, working together with the surrounding agriculture, and being able to deliver to the next bigger city, so to supply the city. The size of like 150 to 300 allows for joint marketing, and that's very important. Marketing is very difficult for a market garden, and if that is made in a professional way, big enough, that can make things a lot easier for everybody. And very importantly, the size will allow service sector to be implemented, and as I said, interesting social life anyway. So this is just a rough sketch how things could look like. And very schematic, of course, things could be very different, but the main thing is that there would be, well, like, let's take this one, maybe 100 market farms, and this could be run by families or groups of people who are interested to work together. And the size must not be all that big, so 2,000, 3,000 square meters, quarter acre, a quarter hectare, half an acre could be sufficient to make a good living. There are examples how that can be done, And if these people are not alone, but they have neighbors to work with and people doing complementary things, somebody taking care for reproducing seeds, somebody taking care of making the way to the market, deliver to the city, have people from the city coming out, city children learning about real life besides smartphones and illusion of others. Small farms feed the world. That's what I was very astounded to hear, but it's making a lot of sense. Around 70% of all food is produced by family farms, according to the World Agricultural Report. Expansion of family farms can be done by such new towns, gardenering projects, and the research can help in this. So the new town may look like this. So that would be a cluster of maybe 100 micro farms, not too many less, because then it wouldn't be enough life. The distance to a city should not be maybe more than 1 or 2 hours transportation time. For smaller cities, it's often very nearby, so that you can really have a medium-sized city, and right around the corner of the city perimeters there could be market farms. And yeah, working with large-scale agriculture around agroforestry can be here, and so on. The idea basically is to secure supply of clean water into the city by keeping the the soil intact, producing high quality food in the new towns and deliver to the city, to a specific quarter of the city, having like relationship to your clients, and people may visit the new town for weekends, vacation, exchanging children, and so on. And of course the city should be greener as well. We are very much promoting to make rooftop gardens everywhere, and this is something what can make people aware of gardening. It could lead to supply of 5 to 10% of the food from the city itself, depending on the climate. But all in all, we need 100% regenerative agriculture. All this could work together. So the soil fodder from the food that comes in to the city, there should be the soil fodder building soil again, and that would be a good combination. Reverse over urbanization and the rural exodus that we see almost everywhere at the moment. Well, we can create abundance in a balanced climate. Nature is abundant anyway, and only if nature is destroyed there will be scarcity, what some people seem to use for creating false markets and so on. And we can have local economy that is supporting interaction with nature. So the pathway could be that we are heading for a desert planet, and that would be very sad indeed, or we can go for a green earth and make a balanced climate. And just to repeat this, 30 billion people could live easily in wells, interacting with nature in a clever way. Whether that does make sense is a different issue, but the stories about overpopulation are ludicrous. It's absolutely irresponsible to fear monger in such a way. There is no excess of people. We should have better livelihoods for people. People should have very good food so that they can develop by their potential. And we need agriculture that is really producing high quality food for everybody so that children can develop their full potential, be healthy in a beautiful world. And that also means that we can reproduce clean fresh water. And the best balance of the climate is to have vegetation cover, to have healthy soils. And that's most of what we can do, besides reducing the horrific air pollution that is also disrupting the climate. Well, 30 billion plus people could live on Earth in wealth. Billions of people are needed for soil restoration, and they can create great livelihoods for themselves and sustain the cities at the same time. All tools are at hand for a good future for all. If we want to achieve a goal, we need to make a plan. And in order to make a plan, we should start with a great vision. So something went wrong here, but just let me keep going. So the new town idea is has come up in 1900 already. So this was Sir Howard in the UK, and he had the idea that around a city there would be these garden towns, new towns, gardening villages, and this was a great concept, and even a few of those were built. Another attempt to go into this direction came from the work from before World War II in Middle Europe, and the idea was to create what is called Gärtnerhof, so that's a combination of gardening and farm. And this was something that is a great idea, and it's already including the zoning that was later rediscovered by permaculture. And the basic idea was to combine gardening near the houses, high quality gardening, with working the land in a different way, keeping animals and so on. And this idea is very ambitious, because the idea was that people do farming and gardening. And that was too complex at the time, as it seems. It didn't really go to scale. And there is only one Gärtnerhof left now near Dresden in southeastern Germany. Well, and then now my idea is there, basically new town, and today we have a lot more options. We know a lot more about different ways of high quality production, highly efficient production, bio intensive gardening systems, regenerative agriculture and all. And so that's my idea, to have these clusters of small farms, different sizes, however people want to set up their piece. And with that, we would see a strengthening of each and every farm, because the marketing can be done together. And the main thing that I brought in, and that is absolutely crucial, that is that it should be like 150 people minimum. So, local economy, around 100 micro farms, direct marketing, maybe via a cooperative, but can be done in a professional way if it's not just for one gardening operation. For the new town, we need highly productive organic farming, ideally in part-time. Not so much that it's not possible to farm full-time, but it can be pretty overwhelming, and in fact many people don't really love to do it in that way, and that's why I think it's great to do this in part-time, maybe three different occupations that are keeping life more interesting. My suggestion is to make modular houses for each micro farm. And if we look at this sketch, there could be such a micro farm modular house. Modular because when young people move in, they wouldn't have that much money at the beginning. So starting a part of a house that can be extended and is flexible in use, I will go a little bit more into detail with that topic. It's an interesting topic, modular houses. Now, like tiny houses are very much discussed at the moment, but modular houses are much more interesting in my point of view. We can create energy and water autarky. Water autarky, wastewater reuse is my special topic. And it's easily possible, especially if there is enough space, and reuse of nutrients is possible, and we don't want reuse from the toilet to the food production, but we have enough space for reforestation, improving soils for industrial crops and so on, so that we don't need to go to food production, what many people hate, including me. So, small production units in shared workshops, 3D printers, fab labs and all that. Shared office space to make also office jobs more interesting. People have employment to meet people also. And if they have self-employment, they can meet others that do the same thing. The white biotechnology can go a long way, so that would be small companies that are maybe having 10 to 50 people, maybe also working part-time. And the size of 150 people allows for childcare, school, care for the elderly, very important topic. And that's something where we can have a lot of, well, positive impulses for a region that otherwise would be, well, abandoned. And so there are quite a few good approaches to this. And for local production, there is an organization called Open Source Ecology, and they made the Global Village Construction Set. So around 50 ways of making something in a normal workshop in a normal garage, as you can see here, and even up to building a small tractor that, in my point of view, should be electric to avoid noise and to allow for regenerating the energy. It's amazing, isn't it? And then also there is one thing, reproductive seeds. This is fundamental for local wealth. So if the seeds can be reproduced, and once again having enough people, there could be a few specializing in this. So one market garden could know everything about all the different lettuce seeds that are possible and exchange them, market them. And another one would be a specialist for seeds for beetroot or whatever. So the varieties of plants, edible plants, is tremendous. And by the crazy monopolies that have been built, this is sort of, well, at risk of being lost. But it doesn't happen because so many people are now working into researching old seeds, and so many organizations are working to this end, and that's very hopeful. So many people are waking up to make a good future. They are not visible. The mass media is sort of very rarely reporting, but millions of great projects are popping up around the world. And basically, I'm very positive that we will get to a very good future. And here's an interesting fact. In like more ancient cultures, inheriting knowledge about local seeds, plant varieties, and nutritional and healing properties can take one third of a lifetime to learn. So just imagine how complex that is, that people would sort of commit their life's purpose to these topics. And what do we have today? We have a tremendous misuse of science and politics and world monopoly for hybrid seeds, this complete nonsense. And that's only marketing, it's ruthless marketing, and it is something what cannot be accepted if we want to build a good future. Now, one example, so this is a, well, this is farmland in southern Germany. Look at the beautiful Alps in the background. And this farmland was converted by a family into like permaculture type of a market garden. So many different varieties and so many different things are growing here. There is a waterway opened up. There are different more plants growing, edible plants. There is plenty of space for animals and birds, and it's like very high quality. And this is now not really there. There is a yurt for now, but I've put in one of these little modular houses that were developed by students. And so that can become a very nice place to live and a productive one. In this example, this was researched by biologists, and there are 16 plant species here on this organic pasture. There are 182 plant species in this permaculture operation. And most of them are edible and even perennial, so plants that come back year after year without people having to work hard to get them back is a very good way forward. So now about high yield local production and some TOHH research. So we are working on this, and one of our projects is the utilization of highly productive floating plants for water reservoirs and in aquaculture. And this work has been performed by Stefan Hügel. And the idea is to use azolla and duckweed. So that's the duckweed around here. And the azolla is a floating fern, and both are very efficient. And if we look at protein productivity, beef, mutton, very low, pork, still low, poultry, better, eggs, bit better, dairy, still very low. But then if we look into such a system, duckweed, carp, as one of the examples that we are researching, the productivity of protein can be so much higher. So just imagine the consequences of that. And these are some pictures now from what Stefan has done. And so the first idea was to work with the ducks. That had its downsides, was difficult to get the right species, but duck eggs are high quality and pretty big, so it is a pathway to go. Stefan moved to raising chicken that were fed on the floating plants. Of course, the ducks get that directly. The chicken love it, and it works pretty well. But as a consequence from this project, it was concluded that grass carp is a better way to go. Tilapia and grass carp, and this can be a highly productive system then. So an impression from this project, and so inside we made it with a greenhouse as a thermal buffer so that we can also raise tropical or subtropical plants. And just look at this taro here. It's like just amazingly productive and high quality food. And you see Stefan there working on it. And here in the background, this is the pond of 100 cubic meters in a greenhouse. And Stefan now wants to move into a more subtropical country to set up these systems in regions that are more suitable. Yeah, another impression of this project. It's one of my favorite projects that we have done so far. Small-scale housing, tiny houses and modular systems. That's also part of what we do as research, and I'll show you examples. So this is a tiny house. In fact, that's my own. And I'm building a modular house next to it now. But a tiny house is maybe a starting point as to set something up. But they are far from being ideal. But there are improved versions. So there is the Wohnwaggon und Wohlwagen from Germany and Austria, respectively. And these are having a living space of 10 square meters plus a push-out space. And these are really nice, so I'll take my picture back so that you can have a look inside. And so that's an interesting way to go. And even they are going for energy autarky, water autarky. But the downside is that through the limited space, there is still quite a bit of heat losses. Because the walls are not that thick, And even if they are very well done, still that's a lot of loss of energy. And for most situations, you don't need these wheels and the transportation. So that's a lot of material and investment just for something that is not used a lot. So I'm, well, I like these tiny houses for setting up something modular, maybe, and also for people who like to move. But basically, I like to develop more on the modular houses level. Here, once again, there is this group Open Source Ecology, and they have developed a modular house of 3 by 3 by 3 meters, 10 by 10 feet, and so there is a integrated energy system here. Living space is upstairs there, so it doesn't take up space from the very small footprint of the living space. And this is an extreme example, I have to admit, but well, maybe as a starting point for not having to borrow money from the banks, it would be great to be independent and first start your farming endeavor before you really go into well, building a bigger module for the house. Then there is the own home of Clemens Jakob, and Jakob, and you find him in the website Own World, Own Home. I should have it somewhere, but you will find that in the internet. A great house, 18 square meters. Also upstairs there is sleeping space. I've stayed in it 3 times already when I gave presentations there, and it's very cozy, very interesting, and it can be brought in on a truck, but it's not made for being taken apart and mounted elsewhere. But that could be done in other concepts, and that would be a way forward. So now my own development is a research project, modular house, 2 units, and it can be used as one house, so as the total of this, or 2 flats with separate doors, and that makes well the utilization a lot more flexible. And so there is also a greenhouse attached so that there can be high quality food production even in winter time. And that's the original design, and so that's the idea, is to have a market garden, and so that would be here. Then greenhouses would be attached to have more living space and to expand the production time of the year. And this would be a small house with 36 square meters of living space. That would be around 350 square feet. And so that's something what is well, very interesting as a starting point. And expansion by greenhouse can be done. This picture was taken in January in Sweden. It was really, really cold outside, and we had a nice dinner in the greenhouse. And the idea of the module is, so in order to have a good way of living also with two people, there should be two separate rooms where a door can be closed. And the idea of this modular house is that you would either put two on top of each other. That's what I'm actually building at the moment. It could be side by side, so one module and another module. Meanwhile, I would take it further apart so that there is a big greenhouse in between and so on. And in the extreme, it could be extended to such a complex of like four houses as a cluster, whatever the demands are. And that's something what makes things flexible. And it could be done in a way of a construction that you could take the modules apart, but that's not what I have in mind for now, because that house should go there, and I build it in a way that it can last for 500 years, and then doesn't make sense to put it elsewhere. But a house that can be taken apart and built elsewhere might be important in areas where you don't know if the whole development will go well, and then it's something where it might be wise to be able to pack your house and move elsewhere, because a house in the wrong place is not only worth nothing if you're unlucky, but it can actually cause a lot of cost to just keep it intact, and like being able to move with the house would be good. And I'll show you one concept where this is realized. So reuse oriented sanitation, and that was my major topic when I finalized with becoming a civil engineer in wastewater management. I realized that our systems are linear flow and we need reuse of the nutrients for many reasons. So the systems we do have today are not made for reuse, and that's something that is a big risk for our future. And so in such new towns, it's not very difficult to make decentralized systems. I was inspired very much by the Tarapeta systems, where the ancient cultures from thousands of years back, until they were destroyed around 500 years back, unfortunately, they probably had toilets like this. And the evidence, it's not really provable, but the evidence shows that there were pots like this here, and they were sort of, there was something leaking out here, so that indicates that there might have been toilets under lactic acid fermentation. And that's an interesting way to make them smell free. And this is a hypothesis of Dr. Heiko Piplo of the German Minister of Environment, and that's, it's a likely scenario. And from that we have developed the Tarapeta sanitation system, and this is a cross-cultural toilet, container toilet, where excreta can be recovered and used for soil amendment. Yeah, making compost also from the bio-waste, of course, that does make a lot of sense. And of course, decentralized energy, renewable energy, solar panels, of course, they are available at low cost, but we need some addition to that, and that could be wood gas technology. Wood gas stoves are available. This is the one made from loam, and this is a project, the Noah stove by Marius Bierig of Polem, and also Jörg Fingers from Climate Farming is working on that. And this could go together with a little Stirling engine, for example, to make also some power. In a more professional way, there is small Stirling engines that could be running with all the heat that you have available, and that could be sort of the flame from a wood gas stove that is producing charcoal, while you can use the remaining energy for cooking and also for making power. This system is not really established yet very much, so there's a lot to be done, but we can create high quality charcoal, and the pulver, the powdery part of the charcoal, it's around 10% of the production, can be used for soil improvement in the way of terrapeta from the Amazon. Mixing bio-waste compost with some charcoal makes very, very long-lasting fertile soils. Finally, an example, a new town design. So this came from a master thesis of two people of Hafen City University of Hamburg, the architectural city planning university, and they came up with a great design, and their task was to design a new town, especially the modular houses. So see what they have done. This is a farm that was chosen, and this farm is it's in a nice location near River Elbe, and there is the old farm buildings, and so around that the design was to have all these market gardens, and a little closer up, so this would be the plots with modular houses. And well, it takes architects to make gardens not in green, I think. So that would be market gardens, maybe with greenhouses and so on. And so this, the part of the farm inside here, that would be sort of the center of the new town, where community space could be shared offices, shared workshops, a cafe, a restaurant, and so on. And the house they developed is modular, so there can be a one person or two person module, and but you can also cluster a few of those to make it for a bigger family or a group of people living together. And this is absolutely fantastic, and the idea is that these the parts of these modules can be packed on a truck, so that this would all go on a container truck, and so you only need the wheels when you really move, and you can have a house that is very well insulated and would not require that much energy. Okay, that's the project of Milan Pripno and Jan Bock, and they are both further interested in this topic. The budget. So, conversion example, conversion of a maybe 100 hectare farms, 250 acres. The total budget would be, as an estimate for northern Germany, there are many areas more expensive than that. But that would make like 10 to 30 million euros, and that makes a sum per unit for the ground, a mini house, micro farm, between 100,000 to 300,000 euros. Those that are working in that, they are building their retirement safety by creating a productive unit. And an entry point can be tiny house, but better modular mini houses. Legal situation can be tricky. It should be agricultural units, so then it's more feasible from the law. You must prove that you do commercial gardening operations, and then it can be legally accepted as a farming unit. But that's something to negotiate with local authorities, to show them the advantages with often fast shrinking populations and the die-off of villages. And so that can be very welcome by mayors. And I've heard that from many already. So many people are looking into this now, and projects are starting. Yeah, well, once again, this schematic picture, it can look also differently, of course. And just to repeat, it should be aiming at very good life, at like very, very interesting lifestyles, and not doing one thing all day, sitting at a desk at a computer for 30 years of your life is, well, that's sort of maybe a waste of this this beautiful life on this fantastic planet. And here people can really do different things and even still be connected, of course, to the outside world. It's not meant to be somewhere far, far out, but it's meant to be in a reachable distance for a city, not into commuting, because that's against the idea. It should be creating jobs in the rural and transporting goods to the city, but there's nothing against visiting the city from time to time. And so a living exchange can be established. So small farms feed the world, just a repetition, and that's why we need many, many more small farms. And to, well, bring more small farms, this could be the idea of new towns, of gardening towns, market garden towns, market garden clusters, and so on. So that's how it might look from a little bit further away. Make it beautiful. So in areas that are not so beautiful, create lakes where you can go swimming, where you're raising fish with floating plants. I've shown you how efficient that can be. Have a lake inside the village. Create agroforestry. So even boring agro-industrial areas can be converted to something beautiful. Have big forests nearby or create them. And so the number of options is endless. So why don't you become a new town planner? So just choose a profession that is able to change the world, if this goes to scale, and to have a good life. And as a short repetition, so this is the idea to assure the city or the Stadt, the life survival of the city by assuring the water supply, assuring food supply from new towns, also from roof gardens inside the city, to make kids aware that there is something like gardening and there is a world beyond well, being a dedicated robot on a smartphone. And so all of this is possible, and still we don't have too many examples, so many more projects are needed. Project work, always project work, master thesis, doctorates, always welcome, and start something yourself, and that will be great. Conclusions. Cities need a healthy surrounding. Millions of people are needed to create them. Soil and humus health are key to water and food security and a balanced climate. Climate change mitigation is mainly done by changing to regenerative agriculture, reforestation, agroforestry systems, and all that. Water, wastewater, and nutrient regeneration, including the important trace elements. So if zinc is running out in 21 years, we have a real problem, and it's a real life problem. So that should be addressed. And city and rural should be working together. Regenerative solar energy supplemented with wood gas technology. Bioenergy is very often destructive and increasing famine in the world and destroying land by agrochemical production. And the wood gas energy is combined or can be combined with food production, with sweet chestnut, with walnut trees, and many others. And so the biofuel is just a side product, and the wood can be a house for 500 years before it is then going into wood gas systems. And there are plenty of highly interesting life perspectives for clusters of producers in rural areas. People can participate in building a good future for themselves and greener planet for a good future for all. And with that, finally, why is this not running? So I hope you enjoyed this lecture. If you like to participate, there are many, many ways. Create your own local projects. Work for this while you study. Do project works, master thesis. Become a new town planner. Become a consultant for market gardeners and farmers. And pick what really excites you most. Don't think that occupation, employment needs to be something that's no fun, that's hard work. It can be hard work, but it should be so exciting that you love to do it. And I achieved this for myself, so I love what I do, and this is possible for you as well. So, if you like this, spread the word and participate. Thanks for listening. Bye-bye.